by Rio Grande.
Buckingham Police calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 173. Regarding a hit and run. Be on the lookout for a red Ford truck thought to be the machine involved. May have a smashed front end from the impact. Driven by one man. That's all. Rosenquist.
As a result of the 50 million mile test given Rio Grande cracked gasoline by your police cars and other emergency equipment, thousands of new motorists are now enjoying the thrill of police car performance. Here is a typical Rio Grande service station conversation.
Well, I heard you calling all cars broadcast the other night. Here I am.
Well, that's good. Glad you enjoyed it.
Oh, that isn't what I mean. Oh, I'm grateful, of course, for the entertainment, but what I really want is some of that police car performance in my car.
Well, that's still better. May I fill her up?
Oh, about 10 gallons. That won't make a 50 million mile test, but it ought to mean something.
You'll certainly be able to tell the difference.
You know, that 50 million mile test by police cars is the most convincing statement I've ever heard about gasoline. That's the reason I came in here. Oh, I've been hearing about gasoline drones for years, but 50 million miles of actual driving by police cars, that sounds convincing.
And it is convincing. Police officers drive harder, faster, and under more varying conditions than any other group of motorists. And so it means more when police officers overwhelmingly choose Rio Grande cracked gasoline. This gasoline powers more police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment wherever it is sold than any other brand. It gives them, and it will give you, police car performance. Once again, we present Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department. Chief Davis.
Good evening, friends. Tonight, we are varying the type of story usually heard on Calling All Cars to bring you something close to the hearts of everyone. The appalling death list that is already climbing to new highs in the early months of the new year makes it apparent to every one of us that something has to be done to curb the useless loss of life caused by automobiles on our streets and highways. We of the police department have done everything in our power to bring to the minds of the motorists the seriousness of this problem. And now, through the medium of the radio, we are appealing to you as individuals to stop and think before you drive. To stop and think of what it would mean to you were something to happen to one of your loved ones. To realize that the time to do something about it is now, before it is too late, and not tomorrow when it may be. Naturally, all traffic fatalities are not caused by hit-and-run drivers. But we have chosen this type of story tonight because we feel it may bring a little closer to home the fact that the police department is active every second of the day and night in its endeavor to stop this mass killing. And because we feel that you, the listeners, may gain some small idea of the seriousness of the situation. Remember, think before you drive. Anticipate an emergency before it happens. And the chances are that when it comes, you will be able to avoid it.
It is a warm July evening. 50-year-old Mary Combs and her swain for the evening, Robert Simo, 43, decide to finish off an evening spent at the neighborhood theater in a fashion befitting the occasion.
Well, now that we've done the theater, Mrs. Combs, what would you say to a final touch? Something along the lines of perhaps an ice cream soda?
Oh,
with a large topping of whipped cream.
Oh, I think that would be perfect, Mr. Seymour. I declare, I don't think I've enjoyed an evening as much as this in years. For many years.
Good. In that case, maybe we can do it again. After all, I'm pretty lonely sometimes. And it isn't every day I get a chance to take a young lady to the theater.
Mr. Seymour.
Well, we won't find any shelters by standing here. That's certain. May I offer you my arm, Mrs. Combs?
You may. And where are we going to find this wonderful soda with the cream on it?
That's a surprise. Something I shan't tell you until we get there.
Oh.
A little place of my own discovering down on the other side of the freeway.
And I can't ask anything about it.
Well, you can't. All you may do is to walk with me across the street and get.
Well, then shall we start?
We shall. Come on. And hold on tight to my arm crossing the street.
You know, Ralph, this is why that makes me feel all sort of funny inside. Like I want to cry. Only I want to laugh, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, did you notice that old couple in front of us, Miss Hillary? The way they kept kind of looking at each other?
Yeah. That's them over by the corner.
I think maybe they must be in love, too, Roy. Just like you and me. Only maybe a little different.
Oh, they're too old. They don't know anything about love like we do.
We look at them arm in arm, like a couple of sweethearts. Just like they were, old Roy. Gosh, makes me feel all sort of sad inside.
Yeah.
They're going to cross the street at the corner. Look at them, they're laughing. Gosh. That'll make you feel funny, too.
Yeah, only...
Only what, Roy?
Nothing. I was only thinking that... Well, you've been talking about them all the time, and I thought maybe you'd be thinking about me.
Oh, Roy, I am thinking about you, honest, all the time. Well, it's just that I can't help watching those two and thinking how happy they are. Like a couple of... Women!
Huh?
Oh, that's right.
Brings him to the office, where he answers the officer's questions.
gives them all possible assistance.
And it's going to be quite a job, I'm afraid, Lieutenant. You see, I have 25 sorts.
25? That means that while we waste time checking them, the one we want may be on his way out of town.
Well, there's one thing that might help, though. You see, each driver owns his own car, and they aren't all the same make. Yes, and also some of them are in Riverside and others in Long Beach. That'll narrow the field down some.
Yeah, some. It'll still leave plenty of them to run down and question, though.
Well, here's a list of cars and drivers. We'll go over this together and eliminate all those that couldn't, Lieutenant. With that, I guess it's up to you gentlemen to finish the job.
I think you're right, Mr. Baker. So before the night gets completely away from us, suppose we begin.
Right. Well, now, let's see. Here's one who couldn't have done it.
I'll check him off.
And here's another. He's in Riverside.
I check.
Webb, I see. He's in Long Beach tonight.
So patiently, hour after hour, the three men go over the list of known drivers. Eliminate one after the other. Double the search down to a handful of the original 25. And this completed, they make a minute inspection of the trucks in the garage. Find no evidence that would link them with the fatal accident. Their mission at the pie bakery finished, Hurst and Cawthorn begin the tedious job of checking the names on the list, questioning the suspects. The first address leads them to a place on Virgil Street where two of the drivers, George Walter and Harry Ballin, live. And as they approach the house, sounds of music indicate a party to be underway.
Sounds hot.
Yeah, too hot for the home of a guy that just killed someone.
I don't know about that. People are funny things, Ted. You ought to know. Shall we ring, knock, or just walk in?
Yeah, let's knock.
Shoot.
Well, no, of course not.
Why, of course not.
Well, I mean, just I haven't seen him since, that's all.
Say, what's this Paul's last name?
I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you, Walter. We're going out and find this Paul fella. But just in case he comes in here with that truck, telephone us right away. Understand?
Yeah. I understand, all right. If he comes back, I'll be here washing dishes.
Not entirely satisfied with Walter's story, yet anxious to run down every lead, Hurst and Cawthorn stop at the Culver City Police Station and tell Sergeant C.J. Trushell to be on the lookout for the truck as well as the mysterious Paul. Then decide to inspect the scene of the crash once more. Accordingly, they drive there, look around for clues.
Well, probably nothing we can get here, but we won't have to look around now that the mob is left.
Yep.
Now, here's Gorville over the street here. Might take a piece in case we find the truck so we can match it.
Yeah. Here's it, Hunk. Say.
What's the matter?
I figured this was grass on the windshield, didn't you?
Sure.
Well, it isn't.
Huh? Hey, let me look.
Yeah, here.
My golly, you're right, kid. This grass is from a bottle or several of them.
That's what I'd say.
And in that case, maybe we're not going to be able to identify the truck so easy as that. Matter of fact, maybe one of the trucks over the garage that we looked at was the one. We were looking for one with a busted windshield.
Yeah.
And that puts a slightly different complexion on things. Hey, what do you say we take a run back to the Checker Cafe and see Walter? His friend Paul might be back. Anyway, I'm not so sure I believe everything you told us tonight. I'd like to talk to him some more.
But as they approach the vicinity of the Checker Cafe, Cawthorn suddenly grabs Hurst's arm, points to an object down the street a little ways.
Larry, look. Up ahead of us there. Looks like a truck.
Yeah, it is a truck.
And it's painted red.
Oh, it couldn't be that we found our pie truck.
Pull up alongside here and we'll look at it.
Baker's Pies.
That's the baby, all right.
Yeah.
And Ted, take a look at that front fender. All crumpled up.
Look, Larry. This truck's only been here a little while. Well, the motor's still warm. I'll bet a dollar to a rotten donut we'll find this Paul fella at the Checker Cafe. That or else.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Come on, we're going back to Walter. Well, Walter, how are you doing with the dish situation?
Huh? Oh, it's you again.
Yeah. Your friend Paul come back yet?
Not a sign of him.
We found your truck, Walter.
What?
Where was it? A couple of blocks from here. It's been on a wreck, Walter.
Then that's the reason that guy never come back. Probably afraid to tell me he busted my truck up.
Now, look, Walter, do you really expect us to believe all that?
All what?
All that stuff about Paul and he's taking your truck. As a matter of fact, you're just trying to cover yourself up. Isn't that right, Walter?
No.
That was funny finding the truck so close to where you are, and yet you say you didn't have anything to do with it.
Now, look here, fellas. Listen, I've been telling you the truth. There is a Paul. He just lives a little ways from here.
You know where, exactly?
Yeah, and I'll take you there. I'm not going to get mixed up in something I didn't have nothing to do with. If Paul busted into somebody, he can take the rap for it, not me.
What do you think, Ted?
Well, I think this fellow's giving us a runaround.
Yeah.
He's the one who was driving that truck home.
No, now listen, fellas, please. You can't railroad me for a thing like this. I'm on the up and up, honest I am.
You were pretty tough tonight when we wanted to ask you some questions.
I know. You see, it's kind of a bad habit of mine, maybe, but it doesn't have anything to do with this. I've been here all evening, and this guy I'm telling you about took the truck to the brewery for some beer. Well, maybe he did run over someone on the way. I don't know anything about that. But that's no reason I should get hauled up on it. Come on, now, let me show you where he lives, please.
Well, I guess there's no harm in that. As long as you don't try any funny ones, such as breaking away, that wouldn't be so good.
Oh, I won't, honest.
All right, Walter, in that case, we can go see your friend Paul.
With Walter sandwiched between them in the front seat of their car, Hurst and Cawthorn drive slowly in the direction given by him.
I'll take it now. Turn somewhere here. Yeah, this is the corner. Turn left here. He lives in a white house down the next block.
Okay. And this had better be the straight good water. If it's not, we're through playing with you.
It's straight, all right. I don't know whether he'll be home or not, but where he lives.
How much further?
Oh, just up the next block. I'll tell you. Hey.
What's the matter?
That's Paul walking along there.
Are you sure this isn't a gag?
No, honest, that's him.
Pull up beside him, Ted.
Okay.
Hey, you, wait a minute.
Huh?
Your name, Paul?
Paul Friend.
That's fine. We want to talk to you. But
never mind that. You just come along with us.
In the car here.
Who are you?
Police officers. Come on, in the back there. You get him back to Walter and keep him company.
Okay.
I don't see what this is all about.
Hey, Paul, we're going down to Georgia Street Police Station.
But
come on, Ted, let's go.
Okay.
Hit a new high at noon. I sure hope it keeps up till Sunday. That's my day off, and I'm going to take a swim at the beach.
Hey, what are you... Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, it's very hot. Say, how about me going to the beach with you Sunday?
Sure, why not? We can get a swell day and a little swimming, a little sunburn, some good old hot dogs. Sounds fine.
Talking of incidental things that have no bearing on the case, the two detectives take a leisurely drive to the police station, going out of their way to make the trip seem longer, completely ignoring their captives who sit huddled in the back seat, silently watching the scenery go by.
I thought all along you were crazy to buy that car. You really got stung. Probably done better in a junkyard.
Hey, listen, I don't have to keep jumping oil in it the way you're doing that hack of yours. Another thing, I get better mileage.
Hey, I'll take you up on that. Why, I can get as high as 20 miles a gallon in traffic this track, and out of a trunk, it's a sink for 25. Oh, here we are. Home. Here's where you get out, Frank. You too, Wallace. Follow me. All right, in here. Colin.
Yes, sir.
Take care of this fellow, will you?
Yes, sir.
You're staying here, Walter. And you're coming with us, Sam. All right. Sit down over there.
Yes, sir.
Well, friend, you know what we want.
No,
you killed a woman tonight, Sam.
No.
Sure you did. And you know it. That woman you ran down in Walter's truck, she died almost instantly.
But I...
You murdered her, Sam, just as surely as you could have with a gun.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, wait a minute.
Made a double. Man, your head just died.
I didn't do it. You fired Walter's truck tonight, didn't you?
No. You had it at 10 o'clock, didn't you?
I don't remember. No, I didn't have it.
Walter says you did.
No, I didn't. I didn't have it.
You know, friends, we have a set of your prints from that time you were brought in for receiving stolen goods. You remember?
They let me go. I showed them I was innocent.
That's right, Paul. And this case has nothing to do with that one, either. But nevertheless, we have your prints on file, and we've got an expert checking them against prints found on the murder truck. He'll be bringing in his report any minute.
I didn't do it. I didn't.
Ah, don't kid me. You're just putting yourself in the middle.
I didn't do it.
Then I guess I'll have to wait for the report. You sure you don't want to talk?
Haven't anything to talk about.
Nothing to talk about, eh, Paul?
No.
Come in.
Here's the report you wanted, Lieutenant.
Oh, fine. Thanks a lot.
Yes, sir.
Let me see. Yeah. Well, Paul, what are you going to say now?
I don't know.
You know what the answer is on these prints, don't you?
No.
The ones found on the truck and the ones on fire here are identical. Not so good, eh, Paul?
I didn't mean to do it. It was an accident.
How did it happen?
I was driving along. I didn't see him. Then when I hit him, I stopped and come back and waited.
How long, Paul?
Until the ambulance got there. That was all I could do.
You were there until the ambulance got there?
Yeah. I didn't see him. The woman must have been wearing dark clothes.
You knew you hit two people?
Well, I knew I'd hit the man, but I thought I'd missed the woman.
You didn't see the woman yet you thought you'd missed her? Well, Paul?
I couldn't see him.
Now, you didn't wait until the ambulance came because there are five witnesses before you leave.
No. I waited. I saw him go. I didn't mean to hurt him.
I'm sorry, Paul, but the game's up. You hit those people and you deliberately left them there on the street. We can't call it murder, Paul, although that's what it amounts to. But we can call it manslaughter and hit and run. For that, you're going to go where people who commit crimes belong, to the penitentiary.
And after a short trial, On the morning of November 29th, 1935, hit gun killer Paul Fan, tense, white-faced, stands before Judge Baird, listens for the words that will ring in his ears forever.
Paul Fan, you have been found guilty by this court of two counts of manslaughter. You've also been found guilty of hit and run, a brutal, cold-hearted crime. Therefore, Paul Franz, I sentence you to serve a term of from 1 to 10 years on each of the manslaughter counts and from 1 to 5 on the hit-and-run charge, all to be served concurrently in Folsom Penitentiary.
So, in this case, justice was done, and Paul Franz discovered the irrevocable fact that you cannot ignore the laws of society and not pay for it in the end. And remember, it isn't the original accident that creates a crime many times. It's the actions of an individual afterwards. The law reads, in case of an accident, stop and render assistance if humanly possible. Killer, you have lived with us the tragedy of reckless driving. Leo Brandy deplores this modern condition and dramatizes it in the hope that automobile drivers may be induced to exercise care and consideration in their driving always. The story also emphasizes another side, the diligence of our ambulance and police service. In this efficiency, Leo Brandy proudly claims a part. Throughout this territory, more emergency equipment is powered with Leo Brandy cracked gasoline than any other brand. In Oakland, Berkeley, Marysville, Fresno, Santa Barbara, Los Angeles, Pasadena, Monterey Park, San Diego, Phoenix, Orange County, Maricopa County, Arizona, and Coconina County, Arizona. Police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment have been powered with Rio Grande cracked gasoline month after month to answer calls of distress. Many of them are lubricated, too, with Sinclair motor oil, a fitting companion to Rio Grande cracked gasoline in providing police car performance. When you go to your nearest independent Rio Grande dealer to secure these products for your car, ask him for a free copy of Calling All Cars News. Learn how you can earn 1,000 gallons of Rio Grande cracked gasoline by helping police catch criminals. Get your free copy tomorrow.
Police calling all cars, attention all cars, cancellation broadcast 173. You got your hit and run accident. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That's all. Frozen prison.